Morals and Man, Part 10, Chapter 12, Diversity in Worship. Quote, "There is no reason in the world," unquote, wrote Augustus Welby Pugin, quote, "why noble cities, combining all possible convenience of drainage, water courses, and conveyance of gas, may not be erected in the most consistent and yet Christian character," unquote. There is in this engaging statement an implication which Pugin, alas, did not see. Quote, "Our domestic architecture," unquote, he had said very truly, quote, "should have a peculiar expression illustrative of our manners and habits," unquote. But these latter he chose, unfortunately, to regard as identical with those of earlier ages, despite the fact that the earlier ages were in no position to convey gas. "We are such men as our fathers were, and therefore should build as they built," unquote. So his argument is summarized. Hence his campaign to revive an architectural form which centuries earlier was already played out, a campaign whose success resulted in the torrential downpour of architectural Brussels sprouts, under which many of our shrines and altars still lie buried. The point, Mr. Trappist Lomax tells us, quote, "was whether or not St. Peter's might be tolerable in Rome and Notre Dame in Paris. It was whether the church in England was to be English or Italianate," unquote. The first tragedy was that Pugin identified Gothic with English. The second, that in the general struggle between English and Italianate parties, while in architecture, Italy came out, in the event, defeated, in the sphere of worship she so largely carried the day. Quote, "our domestic architecture should have a peculiar expression," unquote. So, of course, in any healthy state of society, should everything else, including, preeminently, worship. Sanctity, always in essence the same wherever it to be found, is nevertheless, in this obvious sense, relative. No two personalities are exactly alike. Each race has its peculiar characteristics, each age its peculiar ethos, and the accidents of birth, upbringing, and environment combine with these to make every personality unique. The Englishman differs from the Arab primarily because he is of a different race. The Englishman of today differs from an Englishman of the time of Chaucer primarily because he is of a different age. But, on the other hand, the individuals of a given race in a given age possess many characteristics in common. And it is these which should and normally do find expression in manners, outlook, productions. It is thee to difference ourselves nearer, as Sir Thomas Browne would say, and draw into a lesser circle. It is these which help to differentiate sanctity, for the saint will always, whether consciously or unconsciously, be affected by them, whether by way of assimilation or of reaction. It is these also which should differentiate the manner and formalities of worship, for worship is the offering to God of the whole man, the personality. A formalized offering, where public worship is concerned, but not artificial in the sense of the real. An Italian, who expresses himself normally through the medium of superlatives and incessant gesticulation, may find the unadorned reticence of an Englishman's prayer both chilly and unreal. The Englishman may find the Italian's devotional outpourings unreal and embarrassing. A classical age will shrink from the vulgarity of romanticism. The romantic will stifle in the rarefied atmosphere of classic refinement. The prayers of St. Alphonsus, the hymns of Father Faber, would be incongruous on the lips of St. Thomas More or Bossuet, to say nothing of St. Peter or Boethius. and one does not expect the etiquette of the court of St. James to be identical with that of the court of the Emperor of China. Unity in essentials does not mean uniformity in accidentals. Quote, "In my Father's house there are many mansions," unquote. It is part of that Catholicity, which is one of the marks of the Church of Christ, that its truths should be expressible, its pattern of life realizable in a multiplicity of forms. Nor is this the question merely of what is possible or permissible. The difference of outlook between Greek and the Latin fathers, for example, illuminating as it does two different aspects of the truth, is necessary for the perfection of Christian society. The Latin mind will tend to emphasize the rational, the juridical, the organized. The Greek, to concentrate on the intuitive, the spontaneous, the organic. Both aspects are equally necessary, humanly speaking, if overemphasis is to be avoided. Science can tell us many things about the sun, but not everything. And it left to itself, there is the danger that it will, in fact, kill the sun for us, as Lawrence said, making it a ball of gas with spots. We need the poet and the painter as well. No single race or culture can reflect the entirety of the revelation of God. Only in the cooperation of all nations can the fullness of the body of Christ in this respect be achieved. The title Ecclesia Gentium, writes Dr. Pinsk, contains a double assertion. It asserts in the first place that the church brings something to the nations, the gospel, salvation. But it asserts further that the church, inasmuch as she builds on these nations, also receives something from them. Quote, "To every nation will the church bring the grace and salvation of our Lord, and from every nation will she inherit," unquote. It is surprising, in view of these statements, that their author should go on to develop the surely contradictory thesis that Roman Hellenistic culture is the one human medium of Christianity, so that whoever would accept and endeavor to live the latter must also accept and endeavor to live the former. Just as all men, if they wish to come to the fullness of the life of God, are referenced to the human nature of Jesus, no matter whether they are man or woman, so are all nations, no matter to what race they belong, referred to this one church, which is not a spiritual creation, soaring above all worlds, but which represents the Spirit of Christ in the concentrate, incarnate forms of a definite historical culture, the Roman Hellenistic, and it makes these forms, in view of their content, binding for all men. This means, in plain words, that no race and no national stock can come out of its natural instinct, replace these forms by others. Though they may not tend by nature to mold their religious life in such forms, there is surely in this contention a direct denial of the fundamental principles of Christian teaching that grace does not destroy, but perfects nature. Since it argues, in effect, that this form of culture must be adopted by races for whom it is unnatural, connatural. The Eastern mind must be forced to think in Western terms. The Chinese must learn to honor Our Lady through the medium of the art of Saint Sulpice. What is essential in Christian worship is the sacrifice of the Mass. And the Mass, as the historical evolution of its ceremonies and prayers sufficiently shows, is patient in accidentals of indefinite variation. The idea of sacrifice in general is common to the whole race of man. Its outward forms vary. And while the substance of the Christian sacrifice must necessarily remain the same, and its universal acceptance presents no difficulty, since cultural differences are here in no way involved, The accidentals, the ceremonies, or music, or surrounding prayers, can and ought to vary. The question of variation is of fundamental importance in the problems of the reunion of Christendom. Maritain, Massus, and Moenius are correct in speaking in interests of union when they say that Europe is not the faith, nor Western culture the Roman Church. Oriental Christianity can never be the same as the Christianity of the West, and we shall be impeding the spread of the gospel if we try to make it so. The English way of worship is not the Italian way of worship, and we shall impede the work of union if we try to make it so. In the Middle Ages, England was estranged from the papacy by the presence of Italian priests and prelates. In modern times, it has been estranged by the presence of Italian practices. There is, as Pugin saw so clearly, an English tradition of piety and worship. It is that which we must cling if we are to be such a thing as a healthy English Catholicism. In the days of the Revival, it was in this respect the Italian party whose influence predominated. Hence the uncongenial character of so many of the externals of worship in this country, and the consequent difficulties in the way of reunion. For we cannot expect the average man to distinguish between the accidental and the essential, or be ready, in Tyrell's phase, to, quote, swallow the sentiment for the sake of the dogma, unquote. There is no church, wrote Sir Thomas Browne, quote, whose every part so squares unto my conscience, whose articles, constitutions, and customs seem so consonant unto reason, and, as it were, framed to my peculiar devotion, as this whereof I hold my belief, the Church of England, unquote. To make what is framed to one's particular devotion the criterion of religion's truth would be, of course, to start at the wrong end, to make the human the measure of the divine, to choose a religion because of its congruity with one's particular predilections or characteristics, or indeed with those who of a race of nations, would be to make religion void. There can never be any question of trying to force the revelation of God into consonance with human ideas. But given the revelation and the principles it involves, a relationship of de jure, congruity, is established from which the practical conclusions may in fact be drawn. If the supernatural is the sanctification of the human, and the human not in the abstract but in the concrete, then it implies the sanctification of the proper characteristics of the various races and nations. It implies the utilization in the service of God of precisely those customs which are framed to their particular devotion. It would, then, be mistaken to suppose that by working to make Catholic worship in England more English, we should be in any sense trying to make religion palatable at the expense of truth. We should be helping to throw open a door. A door, it is true, leading only to the antechambers of the church, which is now in some degree closed. It is easy for us to say that those outside the church should come in, not for the sake of accidentals, but for the sake of essentials, and if necessary, in spite of accidentals. That will not excuse us from responsibility if the approaches, the preambula, are made truly unduly difficult. To give Catholicism an alien shroud is to give it the appearance precisely of an uncatholicity, of a particularity in space and time and an exclusiveness which deny divinity. And, to repeat, it is a question of more than mere policy. In my Father's house there are many mansions. The rebirth of a specifically English manner of Catholic worship would add a new enrichment to the many-voiced harmony of mankind's homage to God. Chapter 13. Divine Transcendence and Sorrow. Can there be a heroic humanism? This is to ask, in effect, whether the Christian humanism is possible, a humanism which is not merely compatible with sanctity, but which, without sanctity, without the grace of God, finds itself meaningless and impotent. But the adjective is significant. Heroism implies a more than human effort, a strain, therefore, a tension. And the persistent presence of tension implies for the Christian humanist two outstanding dangers: forgetfulness of divine transcendence and forgetfulness of irredeemable human sorrow. The things that are seen have a directness of appeal to the heart that the greater glories miss for being hidden in the obscurities of faith. Eye had not seen, nor ear heard. It remains then, wrote John of St. Thomas, quote, that the captive soul, bound in the bonds of faith and to its clouded object, can be illumined only by the flame of love, unquote. And there is no mysticism without tears. I sought him whom my soul loveth. I sought him and found him not. But the beauty that is not God is ever present and pulls at the heart to such purposes as to become a potential rival of divinity. So the discovery of God often entails a first reaction against the things that which before had distracted attention from the search for him. And not only pagan literature, says Paulinus of Nola, quote, but the whole sensible appearance of things is the lotus flower, so men forget their own land, which is God, the country of us all, unquote. The whole sensible appearance of things, it is the mystic's dread, Buddhist or Christian, of the great illusion. And in a single sentence, Paulinus has pierced to the secret antagonism, deeper than any occasional wantonness or cult of the gods, between the old poets and the new faith, has revealed unconsciously that which is at once the weakness and strength of Latin literature, its absorption into the actual. True, there is between Buddhist and Christian mysticism a fundamental difference. In the latter, as Miss Evelyn Underhill has shown, quote, we find inclusion rather than subtraction, a growing intuitive conviction that the one shall justify rather than exclude the many, that the life of spirit shall involve the whole man in all his activities and correspondences. The mounting soul carries the whole world with it. The cosmic cross-bearer is its true type. It does not abandon, it remakes, declaring that the glory of the lighted mind, once he has attained to it, will flood the totality of man's nature, lighting up the world of becoming, and exhibiting not merely the unknowable character of the origin of all that is, but the knowable and immediate presence of that eminent spirit in whom we live and move and have our being. As the heightening of mental life reveals to the intellect deeper and deeper levels of reality, so with that movement towards enhancement of the life of spirit, which takes place along this path, the world assumes not the character of illusion, but the character of sacrament. The spirit finds spirit in the lilies of the field, no less than the unknowable abyss. True, there is here a certain world-reducing element, for the spiritual life is of necessity a growth, and all the growth represents a renunciation as well as an achievement. But that which is here renounced is merely a low level of correspondence. The sometimes sterile principle of world denial is here found united with the ever-fruitful principle of world renewal. And thus the essential quality of life, its fecundity and spontaneity, is safeguarded. A perennial inner movement is assured. Unquote. It is this attitude, this handling of the stuff of life, which is new in the spiritual history of the race. This which marks Christian mysticism as a thing totally different in kind from the mysticism of India or the Neoplatonists. The whole man raised to heroic levels, his head in eternity, his feet in time, never losing grasp of the totality of the human, but never ceasing to breathe the atmosphere of the divine. This is the idea held out to us. Fear of the lotus flower, then, is not the characteristic of Christian mysticism, but it is an element in it, for it emphasizes a danger which man must face if he is not to risk a denial of himself. To propose to a man no more than what is human, Aristotle remarked, is to betray man, to will his unhappiness, for by the principal part of himself, the spirit, he is called to something greater than merely human life. Rather the dissatisfaction of Socrates than satisfied piggery, but it is the appeal of piggery which pursues us against our better minds. That the denial of the Christian ideal of humanism is a menace to humanism is the verdict of history. Integrity is, to use Maritain's terms, theocentricity. Humanism emptied itself when it became anthropocentric and abandoned God. Three aspects are moments inseparably linked together and can be distinguished in what might be called the dialectic of modern culture. There is a first movement when civilization gives lavishly its finest fruits, forgetful of the roots from which the sap rises, and is expected to establish by the power of reason alone a human order conceived according to the Christian pattern of preceding ages that have handed down, but which has become forced and is beginning to disintegrate. The moment of Christian naturalism. During the second moment, it becomes clear that a culture separated from the supreme supernatural norms must necessarily take sides against them. Its duty is to free man from the superstition of revealed religions and to open to his natural goodness a perspective of perfect security attained by the spirit of wealth accumulating the good things of earth. The moment of rationalistic optimism. There is thirdly the moment of materialist reversal of values, the revolutionary moment, when the man definitely makes himself his last end and, unable to support any longer a mechanist world, fights a desperate battle to bring out of racial atheism a new humanity. The same process can be followed in regard to the idea of God. The first moment takes as its end the domination of man over matter. God becomes the guarantor, domination. This is the God of Descartes. The second moment hopes to create, thanks to physico-mathematical science, a material world in which man may find, according to Descartes, promise a perfect felicity. God becomes an idea. Divine transcendence is rejected in favor of a philosophy of immanence. With Hegel, God becomes the ideal limit of the development of the world and of humanity. The third moment brings the death of God, which Nietzsche will feel it his terrible mission to announce. Striving to rule over nature without remembering the fundamental laws of his own nature, man becomes more and more forced to subject himself, his mind, his life, not to human, but to technical exigencies. Christian humanism will not adopt the easy way of avoiding this danger of annihilating God and itself by denying the things he has made, and the self-perfection he has set before man as a goal. But it recognizes the infinite disparity between the two allegiances regarded, not, as in theory they must be, as identified, but, as in practice they often are, as divided. It recognizes that, while not incompatible, but on the contrary complementary, the realities of heaven and earth are as far removed from one another as the infinite span of analogy can make them. It avoids the danger of belittling God by laying final stress on his infinite transcendence. In England, you see, H.G. Wells' Mr. Britling remarked, quote, "We have domesticated everything. We have even domesticated God," unquote. Bishop Kirk, in a sermon on the text of Job, quote, "Canst thou draw out Leviathan with a hook, or his tongue with a cord that thou lettest down?" Unquote. Commented, quote, "We attempt to evade the immensities of religion by domesticating, not merely Leviathan, but God himself. Not till we have reversed the process shall we be in a position to substantiate the Christian claim that Christ makes all things new." All serious movements in modern theology are emphasizing this fact. They bid us discard that unwholesome familiarity with God, which has reduced him to the level of a famulus, a household mascot, and start instead of laying our emphasis upon his utter greatness and distinction from all things human, and upon the light unapproachable in which he dwells. They bid us, without surrendering one atom of our love for the humanity of Christ, to dwell first upon the truth that he is very God, a very God, begotten of his Father before all worlds. And they are right. Only so shall we be in a position to understand the genius of the Christian religion, and instead of bringing God down to our own level, we shall set ourselves, by the help of grace, to raise ourselves to this. Christian humanism will not share the suspicions of a Peter Damian or a Bernard of Clairvaux with regard to philosophy, still less accept the radical anti-rationalism of Luther. "The devil," said Peter Damian, "was the first grammarian. And look what use he made of the matter, teaching our first parents to decline God in the plural, 'Ye shall be as gods,' and so making his first grammar lesson an instruction in polytheism. The saint's remarks on the other profane sciences are more highly colored. At the other extreme is the rationalism which will allow of no limitations or dependence upon a higher guidance, but seeks to establish a human order by reason alone. This also Christian humanism denounces, finding both a crown and a corrective to the rational speculation in the supernatural revelation of God. Quote, there are, as in philosophy, so in divinity, sturdy doubts and boisterous objections, wherewith the unhappiness of our knowledge too nearly acquainteth us. More of these no man hath known than myself, which I confess I conquered, not in a marital posture, but on my knees." Unquote. St. Thomas, too, found refuge, when reason failed, in prayer, but to a different purpose. For where Sir Thomas Browne found strength to accept the insoluble antimony of and to quell reason as an enemy of faith, he, on the contrary, found light to resolve antinomy and illumine reason to the understanding of faith. But there is no question of comprehending the incomprehensible. The Thomist theologian, like the mystic, is agnostic, an agnosticism per excessum, not per defectum. Infinitum excelsum creatoris, Miyamon needs himself was not proclaimed the transcendence of the infinite with greater force and insistence than St. Thomas. Negation is, quote, the cornerstone of his teaching about God, unquote. Quote, we begin, he says, by excluding everything material from God. Then we must set aside every perfection, even the most spiritual, which exists in creatures. There remains in the spirit nothing but the revelation of the burning bush, and we call God him who is, understanding by that, with Damascene, an ocean of limitless substance. But this existence itself means for us something created, and we must strip our thought yet further. So we enter into the dark night, to unite ourselves in wise ignorance to him who inhabits the darkness, unquote. We should do injustice to St. Thomas if we were to leave the matter there, to neglect the richness of discovery, which his other approaches to the light inaccessible open out to us, as the flood of light which his doctrine of analogy has shed on reason's search for God. But his insistence on the fact that, quote, at the end of our search we establish, not now as an initial postulate, but as a final and definitive conclusion, that we know about God, not what he is, but rather what he is not, unquote, is a salutary corrective. The possibility of a pride of reason, which in effect takes divinity from God, is paralleled by the possibility of a pride, which excludes his claims as ultimate motive force and judge of our behavior. We may build up an edifice of perfection according, as we conceive, to the divine pattern, only to find our bewilderment and perhaps indignation that comes crashing down upon us that it was a house of cards. Perhaps then, we have to admit, our efforts were vitiated from the start by pride. Perhaps the effort we were making toward self-perfection was but a masked way of self-destruction, since, under the cloak of God's service, we were in reality serving only ourselves. There is, at the end, but one prayer and one principle. The last words of the Religio Medici, quote, thy will be done through my own undoing, unquote. For Christian eudaimonism knows that it is safest in God's hands, secure there alone from the danger of self-deception. In darkness and in safety, by the secret ladder disguised, O happy lot! In darkness and concealment, my house being now at rest. The dark night of the soul is the necessary and the happy, confident prologue to the light of union, agnostic and dumb per excessum, because recognizing that the things that can be said, all the vastness of the theological speculation and all the findings of faith, are lost in the greatness of what is known, but one day to be discovered. The fact that humanism is ready, on its own principles, to sell all that it has at the call of Christ, knowing that therein will be its true fulfillment, throws light on the second danger, which threatens a too superficial acceptance of its principles. We shall deny those principles and at the same time do hurt to Christianity if we allow ourselves to forget for a moment the dead weight of sorrow and pain in the world. The problem of evil has an answer of a sort in philosophical speculation. The Leibnizian solution that everything is somehow or another for the best in the best of all possible worlds was demolished once and for all by the irony of Voltaire, nor can we espouse the equally unsatisfactory policy of saying that everything is for the best in the worst of all possible worlds, which would mean the passive acceptance of all the evil which confronts us. But we could see a purpose in the ascetical value of suffering, in the value of evil in opening our minds to the idea of good. Theology is necessary to carry further these partial and unsatisfactory solutions of the problem, for there is no adequate answer outside the cross. This Christian answer was beautifully expressed in Tyrell's Nova Adventera. Quote, "We need not, however, suppose that antecedent to the forevision of the fall, an incarnation has been decreed, but may believe that God, casting about, so to say, in the infinite resources of his divine intellect and power, for an order of things which should manifest his attributes, chose that in which his mercy and generosity would be displayed more fully. He chose, rather than the contrary, that world in which the race, engraced and elevated, would cast away its privileges, in which iniquity would abound that the grace might superabound, in which his good gifts would be despised, squandered, abused, not merely by some, but by most, in which his richest schemes of mercy would be thwarted by man's perversity, in which he would gladly spend himself and be spent, though the more he loved, the less he would be loved, in which, in a word, his labor should be largely in vain, his love largely unreturned. For plainly this is the showing forth of a far more prodigal and wonderful love, a love of the undeserving and unthankful. Had all men used his graces, what should we have known of his tender mercies, fullness of compassion, long-suffering, and great goodness? We should have known Christ, but not Jesus, the King, but not the Savior." Unquote. That it was not the intention of God that man should acquiesce passively in the evil which is always and in every age he is confronted is clear from the person of our Lord himself. The cross and the passion are succeeded by and have their meaning in the resurrection. "He died in vain," St. Paul tells us, "if he rose not from the dead." For his sufferings were not passive acquiescence in evil, but its defeat. The cross, not ultimately a tragedy, but a triumph. And if we are to, quote, "fill up what is wanting in the sufferings of Christ," unquote, it is to the continuance of this battle with evil that we are called. Keats found at times, quote, "the creation of beauty, an impertinence in the face of anguish," unquote. There is, at superficial reading, an emptiness and vanity and heartless unreality in the idea of humanism when we are faced with the pain and suffering in which the world is full. It would indeed be a superficial reading of the humanist theory so to regard it, and for the fact that man is a political animal, with all the social duties with which that fact implies, is central to the humanist idea. Yet we know the depths to which our culture has fallen in this respect. Tagore warned of the Japanese against Christian civilization. The Buddhists and Brahmins at a religious conference in Chicago said that, "after an experience of 200 years, we see that your life is a complete contradiction to what you preach, that you are led not by the spirit of love, but by the spirit of self-seeking and brute force." We cannot put down the failure of Christendom entirely to the fact that humanism has become degraded, has ceased to be Christian. The trouble is that we Christians have lost the very humanity of the Christian faith. Again, even when our social conscience is far aroused as to make us bestir ourselves in the cause of the needy, there is a danger, which history has shown to be only too real, that humanism may turn into humanitarianism, and that the Christian duty of serving the poor as representatives of Christ may be replaced by a complacent and unchristian condescension. Quote, look not for whales in the Euxine, of the Euxine, unquote, said Sir Thomas Browne. We should not look for a radical Christian reform of the social structure from politicians or bureaucrats. Yet we cannot acquiesce in a policy of tinkering with the surface of national or international wrongs while neglecting entirely the fundamentals. It remains that with the best will in the world, we cannot expect to see the redress of every wrong, the conquest of every sort of physical and social evil in the world, achieved in a day or two, or a year. When we have done all that can be done by us, when, above all, we have made it clear that the will at least is not wanting, even though our efforts are not crowned with much success, then we can and ought to turn to a last problem with which humanism must be concerned, the resolution of the antimony between the infinite transcendence and the infinite compassion of God. For we can then hope without fear of dishonesty and escapism to show that the Lama Sabachthani of the oppressed is not without its divine reply. Quote, Christ has compassions on the multitude, unquote. We are right to think of the incarnation as God's way of making it possible for himself to suffer with mankind, to bridge the gulf between his transcendence and our human misery. In the Godhead, there is no change. In the divine beatitude, there is no sorrow. Yet we can say with the truth that God suffered and God had compassion. God died for man, since Christ is God and what was done by the humanity of Christ was done by God. These things, however, we might be tempted to argue, are past. They occur 2,000 years ago, and sorrow is best consoled by a present sympathy. Are we to say that God, having once shown his compassion and shared in the suffering of mankind, is now retired into his eternal beatitude, in which there can be no admixture of sorrow, and so shows compassion, in the etymological sense at least, no more? Happily, that the very transcendence which makes God so remote affords proof that this is not the case. To God's eternity there is no yesterday or tomorrow. We say that on this or that day the world came to be. Christ was born, Christ died, but these events are not dated in his divinity, the action of creation or incarnation from the side of God is eternal with him, and the coming to be of the human facts involved denotes no change in his immutability. So we say that on this or that day Christ, in his human nature, began to sorrow or suffer, but what does this imply in the Godhead? Quote, let us consider what eternity is, for this declareth unto us both the divine nature and knowledge, eternity therefore a perfect possession altogether of an endless life, which is more manifest by the comparison of temporal things. For whatever liveth in time, that being present proceedeth from times past to times to come, and there is nothing placed in time which we can embrace all the space of its life at once. But it hath not yet attained tomorrow, and hath lost yesterday. And you live no more in this day's life than in that movable and transitory moment. Wherefore, whatsoever suffereth the conditions of time, although, as Aristotle thought of the world, it never began nor were ever to end, and its life did endure with infinite time, yet it is not such that it ought to be called everlasting. For it doth not comprehend and embrace all the space of its life together, though that life be infinite, but it hath not the future time which is yet to come. That, then, is the comprehendeth and possesseth the whole fullness of an endless life together, to which neither any part to come is absent, nor any of that which is past hath escaped, is worthy to be accounted everlasting. Wherefore, if we will give things their rightful names, following Plato, let us say that God is everlasting and the world perpetual. Wherefore, since every judgment comprehendeth those things which are subject to it, according to its own nature, and God hath always an everlasting and present state, his knowledge also surpassing all motions of time, remain in the simplicity of his presence, and comprehendeth the infinite spaces of that which is past and to come, considereth all things in simple knowledge as though they were now in doing, so that if thou wilt weigh his foreknowledge with which he discerneth all things, thou wilt more rightly esteem it to be the knowledge of a never-fading instant than a foreknowledge of a thing to come." Unquote. Boethius, waiting for death in Theodoric's dungeon, wrote of infinity with a depth and grandeur which no writer has surpassed, and a scholastic thinker, doing violence to language in their effort to imprison his thought in a phrase, defined the eternal in terms of a nunc stans, a standing moment, for we tend to imagine eternity as the infinite prolongation of a line of time, whereas in reality we should conceive it as a point. The man at this moment existing is not more present to God than is the child that he was or the dust that he is to be. Calvary is as present to him now as it was 2,000 years ago, and the will to compassion which brought about it is part of the eternal, never-fading instant, that not past it was never future, but is, to say, part of God's immutable nature. Now there is comfort in the material sharing of pain. The boy in his schoolroom finds his punishments easier if he is not alone in them. But this sort of sharing is not what we mean by compassion. Rather, we mean the presence in another of the will to share in suffering, and it is precisely this will to compassion which is ever present in God. The fact that Christ in his sufferings fought evil and overcame it means for us the duty of fighting with him, strong in the belief that the end of victory will be complete, but the promise of a far-off triumph and cold comfort to present affliction, and it is right that we should draw greater strength from the thought of the infinite condescension of the divine transcendence, the present will to share in the very worst that human life can bring. There is another thing to consider. The existence of what the mystic Julian of Norwich called the love-longing of Christ. What does the phrase mean? And is longing compatible with beatitude? For as verily as there is a property in God of truth and pity, so verily there is a property in God of thirst and longing. And this property of longing and thirst cometh of the endless goodness of God, even as the property of pity cometh of his endless goodness. And though his longing and pity are two sundry properties, as to my sight, in this standeth the point of the spiritual thirst, which is desire in him as long as we be in need, drawing us up to his bliss. Therefore, this is his thirst and love longing, to have us altogether whole in him and to his bliss. Pedestrian theology is often hard to put to it to keep pace with the eagle soaring of the mystics. Mystical knowledge is free of the fetters of reason. It is not the result of a logical process. It is the result of a perception which comes of immediate contact. It is what theologians call supraconceptual knowledge, a knowledge which, while still stopping far short of vision, for we are always in the domain of faith in this life, yet goes far beyond, far deeper than the knowledge with which faith supplies us. For it pierces to the very Godhead by the power of charity, of that very Godhead by the power of charity, and of that wisdom, the gift of the Holy Spirit, which flows from charity. Such perception is on a different plane from the rational processes of the philosopher and the theologian. They must toil in order to reach, by their reasoned way, the results achieved in a moment of quasi-intuition by the mystic. We find a theological explanation of the words of Mother Julian quoted above. The difficulty is clear. Reason will ask, how is it possible that there can be in our Lord in heaven this quality of thirst and longing? There cannot be suffering now in Christ. Mother Julian herself goes on to say that this property of longing is in Christ, not as God, for, quote, anent the Godhead, he is himself bliss, and was from without beginning, and shall be without end, which endless bliss may never be heightened nor lowered in itself, unquote. But as man, for anent that Christ is our head, he is glorified and impassible, yet anent his body in which all his members are knit, he is not yet fully glorified, nor all impassible. But how can there be even in the human nature of Christ, since it's beatified, this quality of longing which would seem to imply a privation, a lack of perfect happiness, while a beatitude is necessarily the fulfillment of all desires, the possession of perfect bliss? The same desire and thirst he had upon the cross, the same hath he yet, and have unto the time that last soul which shall be saved is come up to his bliss. Saint Thomas will provide us with an answer to the difficulty in an article in the Summa, whether the body of or be required for the beatitude of man. St. Thomas puts himself this difficulty, quote, beatitude fulfills every desire, but the soul in its state of separation from the body longs to be united again to it. Hence, beatitude is impossible for a separated soul, unquote. He answers by making a distinction. The desire of the soul, he says, is wholly set at rest as far as the object desired is concerned, for the soul possesses that which is sufficient to satisfy every desire, but it is not set wholly at rest as far as the subject desiring is concerned, for it does not as yet that object in every way could wish. And so, when the soul is reunited to the body, beatitude is increased, not intensively, but extensively. The answer is, at first sight, not very satisfactory. St. Thomas's distinction seems to give away too much. His contention was that beatitude was impossible so long as the soul's desire was not fully set at rest, and he seems now to admit that it is not fully set at rest, and the difficulty remains. What use, one wonders, is it to allow that beatitude is present objectively to the soul, an object sufficient, certainly, to satisfy every desire, if, in fact, the soul still remains perfectly happy, its desires not completely fulfilled? For when we speak of the soul's beatitude, we are apt to think chiefly of the perfect bliss of the subject. Have we got any further? We may imagine a man who should have in his life the means of satisfying every desire, But whom bodily pain, for example, should prevent from enjoying his good fortune? What would call him perfectly happy? We shall find further enlightenment in another passage from the Summa, in which Thomas asks whether hope remains after death in heaven. The souls of the blessed, he says there, quote, cannot be hope for glory of their bodies, only to desire it, unquote. And the reason for this is that the glory desired for the body is not hard to attain because it has inevitable cause. Thus, while it remains true that there is in the souls of the blessed a desire which, as yet unfulfilled, that desire is not incompatible with beatitude because he sees that it will be fulfilled.